Okay, ma'am, we are live now.
Right. Can I see the who are the people who are joining us? I mean the
no,
contacts.
Ma'am, we won't be having anybody on Zoom. We'll have people watching us on YouTube. So we won't know who's joining us exactly.
Okay.
It's not a Zoom.
Right. So can we start?
Yeah, we can. Namaskaram to all viewers of the Lasya Mukharika series. Today, we have a very special artist, a versatile artist, very acclaimed Mohiniyattam dancer, researcher, and also musician, Dr. Deepthi Omcheri Bhalla. Namaste, ma'am.
Yes.
Welcome. Deepthi, ma'am, has a lot of hats and talents of her own. She's from a family with artists. Her own parents are very famous artists. They're from literature and one person from the music field, researchers and scholars in their own right. Deepthi ma'am also serves as the dean for the department of the faculty of music and fine arts at the University of Delhi. And she has a lot of responsibilities currently, and I'm really glad that she took out time to speak to us on Mohiniyattam and her experience through, learning and performing and practicing this art form for several years. So, ma'am, we know that you have rooted yourself in the indigenous Kerala tradition right from the beginning. Your training under Kalyani Kutiyamma teacher is a good example for that. And later on, when you started practicing by yourself, you did go into the Sopana Sangeetam style and looked at traditional talas and sangeeta paddhatis in Kerala to bring out your own style of Mohiniyattam, your own compositions. What we'd like to know first is your training period under Kalyani Kutiyamma teacher.
That happens. These are all very coincidences, you know. Like I would say, providence brings, destiny brings her close to those teachers. I think any student is very fortunate who has a good teacher, who is able to find a guru, a correct and guru like Kalyani Kutiyamma. And you see, I, after having learned 12 years of Kathakali under great veteran masters like Punnathur Madhav Panikirashan, who was the first recipient of Sangeetar Academy Award and the first principal here at the International Center for Kathakali in 1950s, that's when they started. And Delhi had only at that time Kathakali, apart from Kathakali, they had just one Bharatanatyam and I think Kathak. These were the three dance forms that were actually going in Delhi at that time. So my parents, who wanted naturally for me to be remain connected to Kerala, they ensured that I enrolled myself as a Kathakali student. I was barely 4.5 years, very young. So Punnathur Madhav Panikirashan, then we had Guru Gobindnath Ashan, who was the founder of Kerala Natanam. And many, I don't even remember, many Ashans who came for a period of 3 years, 4 years, time to time from Kerala as principals of International Center for Kathakali. And last of my Kathakali guru, of course, was Sadanam Balakrishna Ashan, who's of course now everybody knows, and before I actually ventured into Mohiniyattam. Then I also happened to learn from Nellur Vasudev Nambudri Ashan. When I used to come for my holidays to Kerala, I used to learn from him also. Nellur Vasudev Nambudri Ashan. And then he was, thanks to him, I had an excellent performance, a very good opportunity of performing in one of the temples in Abhyananda Ashrama. Not temple, but Abhyananda Ashrama. I did Udana Moksham actually for almost 1.5 hours. I never knew that you could expand a small little item to such a long duration. So I had, even though I didn't understand anything about what I was learning in Kathakali, but the great masters, you know, who, from whom I learned, the constant imitation somehow made my body and mind absorb the finest elements of Kathakali. So during my holidays, I chanced upon in Trivandrum, Kalyani Kutiyamma used to come to teach classes, take classes in Mohiniyattam in Trivandrum. That is when I happened to meet her. And she immediately took me under her tutelage only because she had very high regard for my mother, who used to constantly contribute research articles in these Malayalam publications and magazines. In fact, teacher was very fond of reading all Malayalam magazines, whether they had literature, anything. She was very fond of reading. So she had great admiration for my mother writing on Sopana music, Kerala Sangeetam and all that. So when I approached her, somebody said she's coming and taking classes. I went up to her and she said, when I said, teacher, I would like to learn from you, she immediately took me under her tutelage. And then she said, what have you learned? So I said, Kathakali. She said, okay, so you start learning the Adavus, that's not a big thing, I'll teach you that. But let us start with a padam. So she taught me Endahu Vallabha. And believe me, that Endahu Vallabha, even though we say padam is one of the easiest ones, you learn the Adavus, everything, Cholkata, Laripur, whatever you may say. You say padam is the easiest musical form that you can actually present. But believe me, it's a very, very difficult form. Very difficult when it comes to Abhinaya. So when she was teaching me, I learned a lot of things which till that time I did not know about how to control your facial expressions, how to constantly not have an artificial smile on your lips. You know, it should not be, you know, like showing your teeth and too much of a smile, and how it should be so subtle. And when you smile, she used to call it as Smita smile. You know, she used to say, Smita smile vachitta kaanikyo abhinayikyo. And then she used to say, always remember that you are interacting with God. Naturally, we were doing only compositions of Swati, which were always towards Bhakti, Nayaka Nayaka relationship. So she would always say that, eppozhum orma vekkanam, orthirikkanam. Nammale Nayakan nu parayunnathu sadharanulla Nayakamaralla. Idu Padmanabhanaan, Ishwaranaan. So when you say he is a God, you have to approach with all restraint, all control, or expressions which cannot be exaggerated or bold. So that was one thing which took me a lot of time to actually master that, because automatically, you know, that Kathakali expressions would come onto my face and eyes. So it took me a lot of time. And then also another thing which she told me was that do not over move your body. It has to be as controlled and restrained. Like, sometimes I have seen that, no, this is something we dancers need to understand. How much to limit ourselves. Only we can know that. I cannot say that only 1 foot, like, even though when you have to, like, Kalyani Kutty Amma was very precise. She wanted that everything should be very concrete, like everybody else. You know, those people who have written Shastras, you will always find you have to draw some kind of a line, a demarcation. For the people who read to know, okay, 1 foot, okay, one tala, tala means when I say a finger and a thumb, the space between that, uru tala, you know, or 1 foot, there has to be demarcation when you're writing a shastra. But when you're doing a prayoga, everything depends on your hand, your body, your height, your limbs, everything has to be viewed from the aesthetic point of view of your body. Right. So when she taught me that this is how, when you sit in Aramandi and when you sway, that sway should not be too much of a, you know, jerky movement or too much of an over exaggerated movement. It has to be very subtle and moving. You know, that's what she used to teach me in Endahu Vallabha. Then that was how I started learning from her. Then unfortunately, it was in 1976. Mm-hmm. In 1978, she became too ill to come to Trivandrum, so I had to go to Tripunithara. And I stayed with her daughter, Srimati Kala Vijayan, who also an exceptionally affectionate person and who taught me some Padavarnams while I stayed with her. There I learned some Jati Swarams and Cholkat. Actually, I learned at that time. Before that, I never learned Cholkat. So Jati Swaram Cholkat. And then Kalyani Kutty Amma, when she came to Delhi, that time also she stayed and taught me at my mother's place, and she taught me some items. So all these things, I had good fortune of learning from her. And when I would say, okay, let me you asked me the second question. Maybe I'll go on and on.
Yes. No, that's okay, ma'am. No, but when you mentioned about toning down the facial expressions for Mohiniyattam, you had come from Kathakali training, right?
Yeah.
Did Kalyan Kutiyamma teacher tell you something specific about the kind of abhinaya that Mohiniyattam needs?
She only told me one very clearly, that everything has to come from within your heart in the form of a bhakti or in the form of a kind of, when you say bhakti, it does not necessarily mean God and the mortal being only. It means that it has, you have to be in tune with what you are expressing. You have to be very much in tandem with that. It should not be that what you are feeling and what you are projecting are completely in conflict with each other. That was so. In other words, it has to be from sattva. If you actually now analyze, at that time she didn't tell me these things like sattvic abhinaya. Maybe she knew, but I didn't understand. So now when I understand that if it has to come from sattva bhava, which is pure, then that bhava naturally is very different from just a kind of an expression that you are trying to show. Imitation. It's not imitation. So that I have tried to all the time remember when I do abhinaya, always.
Okay. Ma'am, you spoke about your mother, Padma Shri Dr. Leela Omcheri, ma'am. How has your experience living with her, growing with her been? Because she is an iconic figure herself, exceptional artist, and with a very keen eye for music, Kerala music specifically. And how was your experience having such a go-to person with you all the time, whom you could always confide in, ask for, you know, resources and ask for her suggestions in your growth development, developing phase in your Mohiniyattam repertoire? So how is it? How was your collaboration with her, both artistically and personally?
First of all, here I'd like to say only one thing, that my parents, both my parents, my father being a playwright also, that was his passion.
Yes.
We were all the time from my childhood surrounded by theater, music, dance, you know, all the time. I could see my mother cooking for 25 people at a time just to have after that some kind of a drama rehearsal or a dance preparation for something. And in Delhi, I'm telling you, in early 60s, there was a very small group of Malayalis. And all this small group of Malayalis, whether they were from the prime minister's office level, or, you know, they were those industrialists, or they were just office goers, or they were just plain little small time businessmen or teachers, or we were like a family, you know. And every time there used to be some kind of a festival or a program happening, the entire family, children, parents would all come join together and have. So this was something that was happening in early 60s and late 60s also. So all the time I was watching music and dance around me. My mother was my first Carnatic music teacher. She would make me sit. Her principle was, children should be made to learn something that they enjoy. You cannot form a discipline in a small child. You have to make that child enjoy what he's listening to, enjoy what he's watching, not make it enforce on them like a discipline or force upon them. They have to learn this in this way. They have to. So she would have small, you know, folk songs of Kerala, which she learned from her grandmother, great grandmother and all that. So she would, all those small little pillari geetas kind, you know, for the children. She would learn, and she would teach not only me, even anybody, all those children would come, she would teach them. Even today, I remember many such small little, you know, like, Chandathil muttam chetti parichillai endende maveli onam vannu. So all these things, you know, small, it was easy for me to learn any time. So, and we used to enjoy. We really used to dance and sing. Now from there, when I grew up by the age of 10, 12, but even Kathakali when I was learning, she never forced upon me to strictly abide by what the teacher was saying. She would say, Dinoka Ashan, Indu Bhani Etichenu, Ashan Unnu Noka. You know, she would coax me, you know, motivate me. So I would look at him, and Ashans were so beautiful people, human beings. They were very affectionate. Punnatha Madhava Asha and people like him were so affectionate. But after the age of 12, then that discipline set in. After that, my mother became very particular that what I learned Carnatic music, or whether I learned Kerala music or dance or anything, I should know what I'm learning. I should be very clear. So then onwards, my actual teaching, as per the, you know, the discipline and a real formatting or whatever you need, that happened after that. Now here also I would say, when I in 1979, when I gave my first performance in Delhi, it was a very short recital. I did one Chulkatta, I did Gendohu Vallabha and Thingalum Kadiroliyum. Thingalum Kadiroliyum. Thingalum Kadiroliyum is a folk song which my mother happened to see Tangamani Gopinath performing, in not in a Mohiniyattam dress we wear today, but in a kind of a folk kind of in a costume, you know, with a hairdo on one side and some kind of a costume which did not, does not, was not off-white and jari and all that we wear today. So my mother saw her movements and she heard and understood those songs. She got that lyrics from, learned from whatever she could gather. And she taught me those movements and that music. She learned me, made me learn that by heart. And she choreographed that piece for me and she said, you perform. So in 79, when I performed these three items, I did not have even a mridangam. There was a Maddalam Muruga Jyoti, who was actually one of the leading performing Maddala players here in International Center for Kathakali. And he was a regular performer till he passed away for Bharti Shivajiji also. And he was an excellent performer. And he, of course, he accompanied me because I couldn't find a mridangist at that time. But of course, the program flopped primarily because the jatis and the musical and the rhythmic setup of Mohiniyattam is more prone to Carnatic music. It's not so close to Kerala music at that time. Mm-hmm. All our jatis, tirmanams, arudis, everything was patterned after Carnatic music, jatis.
Right.
So it didn't match well at all. So after that, when I continued my training from Kalyan Kutima, I started giving a 1 hour recital and all that. I was subjected to a lot of, I would say, criticism, because here in Delhi, there was this comparison between Bharatanatyam, which was much more popular, and, you know, comparison between that and Mohiniyattam repertoire, which was having the same kind of items. And somehow I was always subjected to, was not really allowed to develop myself at that point of juncture. That was a very crucial juncture for me. I would be honest that almost 1982 to 83, I had almost thought of giving up my dancing because of so much of criticism that I was facing. But I stuck to Kalyani Kutti Amma's style. I never gave up. And my mother, that was one thing that my mother told me to abide by. She was saying, don't get disturbed and perturbed by these criticisms. You follow a path. If you are convinced by your guru, what she was following is correct, you see how you can enhance yourself. You don't need to leave that school of teaching. You remain there. But within that format, how can you expand? That is when my mother's teaching and my own research came into some help, because I had a strong Carnatic music background, which I learned from great Vidwans. So my rhythm, sense of rhythm was quite good. So then I thought that why not we research into finding out certain compositions which are typical to the Kerala region, rather than taking a Telugu Varnam, Padavarnam, or a Tamil Padavarnam, as I had learned. You know, I had learned some Telugu and Tamil Padavarnam. So I thought, rather than choreographing that or doing something with that, let me see, along with my mother, how I can enhance and expand the repertoire. So we came across a lot of compositions, many of which my mother had learned through oral traditions from her grandmother, who at that time, you know, I mean, it's a long story which only my mother will be able to tell, or maybe at some point of time I'll be able to tell. being a part of having born and brought up in Kanyakumari district, Suchindram Parashala, this was once the capital of Travancore Maharajas. So there was lot of music and dance, which my mother had direct access to, the temples, the rituals, the folk songs, many things my mother was exposed to through oral tradition. Now, nowhere you find them written at that time, except in certain palm leaves. Odal, my mother used to say, "Vallo odal enikku idu kitti njan adu ezhuthi adine onnu chittapaduthi adu nee choreograph chey." You know, this is how she used to say. In the process, while we found some of those compositions which were written by perhaps some anonymous, like Tyanis, you're a Mohiniyattam dancer, if you look at the words of the Tyanis, the lyrics and the sahitya, it is very clear that it has been written by somebody who was a bhakta, not a literary person. There is no refinement in that. It just comes out from the heart. The music comes out from the heart. Like that, in some of these palm leaves, some people who felt something, they brought it, they wrote something, they sang something. So there was no refinement in music or literature. Similarly, in that process, we also came across some of the compositions which were composed by the Travancore Maharajas. I'm talking about 79-80. That was the time when I wanted seriously to take it up, Mohiniyattam. So there we found Thalamalika Padam of Iraimin Thambi, a few others. We found Kuttikunji Thangachi's Vadithura Pata, and nobody knew at that time that there was something like a javali that finding in Malayalam, because Swati had composed one or two javalis in Telugu, not Malayalam. But no Malayalam compositions were there. And this was a kind of an eye-opener for both my mother and me. So, but the music structure was very fragmented. There was nothing like a music, proper music structure.
Only the lyrics was in place.
Lyrics, to some extent, in some places, there were some notes which were, like typical Kerala notes where you have 3 to 4 swaras coming in, and with the pattern in which they are sung, if you see the old singers who have composed, if you see the musicians, the pattern in which the oral tradition of folk songs were there, based on that, many of the later compositions were composed based on that music. Because they were the foundation, they were the seeds from where the seedlings came. So my mother, having learned all these compositions through oral traditions from her grandmother, she knew idu ingane chittapadathanam aayirikkum. So she tried, tukkaragam. Appa tukkaragam nu parayumbole tukka nu parayumba adile ee swarangal varan chance undu. So she would say, okay, tukkaragam evidekke nammalku kaanan saadhikkum paattalu. So she would search for those songs where Tukka Ragam, you find some combination of that. She would take that, structure it. Everything is based on some kind of a scientific analysis. It is not offhand, like you just think comes out of your mind. No. So everything has to be very precise. Based on that, we found certain prabandhams, nritya prabandhams. If you know that there are 3 kinds of prabandhams, Geetam, Vadyam, nritya prabandhams, which we have in Sangeet Ratnakara, we know, and many other texts also they see. So there was some nritya prabandham, because every composition were not called as Kriti, Javali, Tillana. These all terms came much later, Before that, everything was called as a prabandham. Anything which was structured was a prabandham. So we had some Nritya Prabandhams, and we had some Padams, we had certain other compositions, like what I said, Vadithura Pata, Padams, then Chalis, Shabda Chalis and Shiva Chalis we had. So all these things, we brought it under only with the intention, not with any intention of my coming out exceptionally, like some, bringing out a new repertoire altogether. It was something for me to explore the possibilities within this, which we got from the Kerala region itself. Now, even today, I abide by many of the norms that for which Kalyanikutty Amma was very particular. About the Veshabhusha, she would say, Aharya should be simple, not too gaudy. Because from the gaudiness, There was once upon a time when females were dancing, those with wearing all body costumes and all. We have come to a refinement stage. In that refinement stage, we have to be very, very sensitive to the fact that when the audience and the spectator watch you, your move, they should be only able to be glued to your face and your body movements. And that should be very precise. That should be aesthetically executed, not by wearing those jewelries which make you immediately distract the attention of the spectator. They should remain glued to you. Even today, I follow that. I wear the same simple sari with a jari border, same with minimum gold jewelry. I do not wear the stone studded. You used to say that reflects light, so don't wear the stone studded jewelry. Idonnu idan padilla ella swarna aabhushanam mathram itta madhi. She would always say that. So I continued to do. Only thing which I changed was the headgear. That too, because I was convinced, even though I think for quite some time, though I would say one thing here I want to share with all of you. Kalyani Kutty Amma teacher, just before she passed away, I think 2 months before she passed away, I had gone to see her at Tripolitara. It just chanced that I just wanted to see her and I went. And when I went to her, I told her, teacher, njan ee pinnil kattana mudi njan ippa side la kattan thodangittunde, will you please approve of this change and do you disapprove of that? I asked her that in Malayalam. So she never said angane cheyan paadilla. She was saying njan ingena padichathu, njan adu ningale padipichu, ningal adu engena cheyano adu ningalde ishtam, pakshe njan innum ഞാൻ പഠിപ്പിച്ചതും ഞാൻ ശീലിച്ച ചില കാര്യങ്ങൾ ഞാൻ ഇന്നും അത് ഐ എം അബൈഡിങ് ബൈ ദാറ്റ്. ഐ എം നോട്ട് ചേഞ്ചിങ് ദാറ്റ്. ബട്ട് നൗ ഇറ്റ്സ് അപ് ടു യു ഹൗ യു വോണ്ട് ടു ടേക്ക് ഇറ്റ് ഫോർവേഡ്. ഈവൻ അറ്റ് ദാറ്റ് ടൈം ഓൾസോ ദോ ഷി വാസ് വെരി വെരി ഷി വാസ് എ വെരി സ്ട്രിക്ട് ടീച്ചർ, ഷി വുഡ് മേക്ക് അസ് ഫോളോ എക്സാക്ട്ലി ആസ് ഷി വോണ്ടഡ് അസ് ടു ലേൺ, ബട്ട് ദർ വാസ് എ സോഫ്റ്റ് സൈഡ് ടു ഹർ നേച്ചർ. ഐ ഫൗണ്ട് ദാറ്റ് ഇൻ ഹർ ഹാർട്ട് ഷി വാസ് വെരി സിംപിൾ ആൻഡ് ടു സോഫ്റ്റ്. ആൻഡ് പെർഹാപ്സ് during those last moments, she must, this is what she wanted to tell me, that I do not insist that change for the, but it should, whatever change you are doing for the better. So she didn't, she was not very 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 particular about
it. Ma'am, from what you said about taking those compositions from the churuls in temples at Shuchindram with your mother, at that point were you introduced to sopana sangeetam, or was it in the process that you went to different rhythm maestros to learn that?
That's a good question you asked, because when I was too young to understand the sopana sangeetam, and I'll be very honest that even when I came to the college level, I was 18 19 years at that time, my father belonged to, hailed from Vakyam. There is a Kshetra Kala Peetham there and Vakyam Kshetra is there. So I remember distinctly that my great Vidwans and veterans from Kshetra Kala Peetham, Sopana Sangeetam, they would come at night after dinner and they would sit for hours singing these Alapanas and Sopana Ashtabadis and all that they would be singing, and my mother would record, understand, have her arguments that why do you want to sing like that, why not this and all that. But even at that time, I didn't really understand. It was only while I started doing my PhD in Sopana Sangeetam, in way back in, when I was, I think, in 90s, that was the time I actually understood the procedure of Sopana style. What is the procedure? How do you, what do you call as nila, sthanam, and sthayas? Then what do you call as the various, just taking three notes and moving around those notes, even if it's a Shankaravaranam raga, with all the seven notes, it's a Tristhai raga. You can explore any possibilities in melody when it comes to Carnatic music. But why stick to only the mantra madhya sthai of singing Shankaravaranam with just three notes? Why you want to go to Tara sthai? Why not the entire octave? These certain things I understood only when I started learning, so doing my PhD. And then when I took up seriously Mohiniyattam, that is when two things I did. One, understanding completely the analysis of Kalyani Kutiyamma, how she perceived Mohiniyattam. Read her book that she had written, that she gave to me also, and understood from my complete interaction with Kalachechi. I used to, even now, I have had many discussions to remember what Kalyani Kutiyamma told me, whether it was in conformity to what Kalachechi told me, and it does. So I, basing that analysis, interacting with Vidwans, you see, I have interacted with Neeleshwara Shankara Maharajan. He was the Maram exponent in Neeleshwara temple. Maram is a small rust kind of a drum, wooden instrument, which has no tonal sound like chenda and the maddalam and all. It is meant exclusively for rituals. So it is not meant for a percussion, a rhythmic variables or virtuosity. It is to suit exactly for as the temple rituals demand. You know, it is only for that. I interacted with him, tried to understand what he would say about the play techniques. I went up to asking with Achyutan Kutti Maharajan, Achyutan Kutti Maharajan, Kalle Kulangar, that is his, that's how he knows, because there might be many other Achyutan Kutti, so Kalle Kulangar, Achyutan Kutti Maharajan. He also told me many Pani vehicles and the Melam, the techniques of that. Then Maddala Shankara Maharajan, Trigamburam Vishnu Kutti Maharajan, from whom I learned Dhyanis. And Dhyanis that he has recorded for me, Trigamburam Maharajan, you will find the melodies in the manner in which he has sung those melodies is quite different from the melodies, the same song Dhyanis sung in today many temples by singers. So I asked my mother, why, how come it's different? So she said, Unna bhayankara bhavathode aanu paadi irikkana Ashan. അപ്പൊ ആ ഭാവത്തോടെ പാടുമ്പോൾ അതിൽ പല സ്ഥലത്തും നമ്മൾക്ക് ഒരു വ്യത്യാസം കാണാൻ സാധ്യതയുണ്ട്. പക്ഷെ അത് തെറ്റാണെന്ന് നമ്മൾക്ക് പറയാൻ പറ്റില്ല. വി ആർ നോ ബഡി ടു കോൺട്രഡിക്ട് ദാറ്റ് ബിക്കോസ് എനി മ്യൂസിക് ദാറ്റ് കംസ് വിത്ത് ഫീലിംഗ്സ് ഇസ് ദാറ്റ് സോപാന സംഗീതം. ഇറ്റ് ഇസ് സോപാന. സോപാന ഇസ് ബേസ്ഡ് ഓൺ ഫീലിംഗ്സ് ഓൺലി. ഭാവ ഇറ്റ്സ് എ ഭാവ പ്രധാന മ്യൂസിക്. സോ ഷീ വുഡ് ഓൾവേസ് ടെൽ മീ ദാറ്റ്. And then, of course, Vaitaris that I learned from Padeni, Kalamanetta Vasudevan Pillai, Ruchi Kumar and Nair Ashok, all those Vaitaris, I have tried to incorporate in the rhythmic patterns of Mohiniyattam and see how best I could actually, enhance the rhythmic aspect. Even today, I have been telling everybody, my area of my work in contribution, or my area of contribution, has been exclusively only to the music and the rhythm. The movements is something, there are many dancers who might be creating much, much better than me, because creativity comes from here and here. So there might be dancers who are much better, even the young dancers, I would say, they're remarkable in their executions. But on the rhythmic side and the repertoire side, I thought, I could contribute something, and that's where I'm doing even now. For instance, I'll recite certain Vaitaris. See, I'm just trying to say a food for thought. Don't take it as this is something that has to be accepted. This is for you to work upon. Like in Padeni, there is a Ganapati Tala, which many of you might be knowing. Tak kudik kuta katak kadit tik tik kuta. Now, that tam, there is a pause. After the last beat, there is a pause. That pause in Kerala Sangeetam is taken also as a count. Unlike in Carnatic music, there is nothing like a pause. They have only a beat and a beach and a count, finger counting. So everything is shashabda, nishabda, no doubt, but there is a process. Here, even if the tala is finished, there is a space after which again the tala process starts. So that beach or that pause is taken as a count. In that case, this count happens to be 10.
Right.
Right? 10 counts with the with the pause. Suppose you want to put, say, an edakya pool or an edakya baitari or something you want to take from edakya and you want to incorporate into it in the nirta. How can you do it? Now, when it comes to nritta, obviously there is a, you have to follow a kind of a cycle where there is, you have to come to precise a sama. In the Kerala talas, it finishes in the beach actually. They don't have something like we have a samam in Karnataka. Everything comes and goes into a samam. They don't have. But when you come, bring it to Mohiniyattam, we can do that. I'm not saying we should not do that or we should do. We can do both. Because Mohiniyattam has a Carnatic music also. We cannot do away with the Padams, Padavarnams, which has a different musical setup. And I would say, do not meddle with that. What has been already composed by the great composers of Kerala, whether it is in Carnatic or Sopan or whatever, let it remain. Do not meddle with that, because it will be a flaw. Try to see the other music aspect, how you can enhance it. There you try to put what you have researched or what you have worked on. So here, if you see that, I have to leave 1, 2, 3, 4 counts before I put my vaitari, which I have in mind. So, tak ku dhik ku taka, tak kita dhidhi, I have left that. Dhik ku, from there I'm starting, right? Tak ki 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 nakki to, tak ki 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 nakki to, tak ki 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 nakki, tak ki 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 nakki, tak ki 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 nakki to. Tangita tattitta dikitta dimikitta tungutlangutaddingina tangita tattitta dikitta dimikitta tungutlangutaddingina ei dittai dittittai dittittai tai dittai vidittittai dittittai driku takkai dittai tai dittai tai dittai, right? So this vaitari, when you put it into that, how many aksharas should go? Mm-hmm. How many aksharas should come before or after? Something you can decide when you are putting it in Rupakatala, when you are putting it in a Jampatala, or you are putting in an Aditala. This is how you have to choreograph. So this is how I used to do. So another, I will try to recite another vaitari, which actually I got from Maddala Shankaravarya Rashan. It's a Maddalam Vaitari. Now, how you put it in Rupaka, how you put it in Adanta, or that is, you have to calculate that. Anakina kina taka tari dik kinang tari dik kinang kritak tari kita tari kita dhim. Anakina kina, you can take 4 counts for the time being, sarvalaghu. Anakina kina taka tari dik kinang tari dik kinang kritak tari kita tari kita dhim. Anakina kina taka tari dik. Right? So this is a beautiful vaitari which I got from Madala. Of course, he recorded innumerable vaitaris for me. I had to select to insert in place where I found that could be appropriately set in. Similarly, I took from Puruchi Kumar and Naira Ashan, which was a huge, long vaitari. I did not know how to set into Mohiniyattam. Then I suddenly, when I was choreographing a Nritya Prabandham, Adi Keshava Nritya Prabandham, which is actually a Tiruvattar Adi Keshava Shetram from where my mother hails from. So it is a Dashavatara Varnana of Mahavishnu. And here the two verses indicate the presence of Mudak and Tagada Tala, which are not a part of our performing arts, Drishya Kala. They are a part of the temple arts, right? The Tagada, the Mudak Tala, these are all a temple talas there. So because of that, I try to choreograph that. Now here, when I was trying to show the Kaliya Tandava Lasya Visharada, Kaliya Tandava Lasya Visharada Manjula Jalana Manohara Shikara, Kaliya Tandava Lasya Visharada Manjula Jalana Manohara Shikara, Yadukula. Hmm. when I forget that after these two lines, now I don't remember. Sometimes it just escapes. So here, Kaliya Tandava Lasya Visharada. I thought I could show the Tandava and Lasya of Krishna, how he was bringing about the Lasya aspect through his Tandava. And I could show at the same time the movement of the Kaliya also. So in the Kaliya, I tried to take the melody through the Veena. And in the dance pattern of Shiva, I tried to incorporate the Vaitari of Maitri Tuka. Taka 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 titrakai tata taritom tom tarikita taka duvitum gattita kota tarikita tanjekum tom tarikita taka dattatum daginangi dittatum daginangi tatatum daginangi dittatum diginangi tungikum tira kota tarikita tatpudikku takkita takra gadita. Now this is, it ends like that. How you want to mold it, you can do it. So long as it conforms to the rhythmic pattern, you can bolt it. Right? You can take it three times, you know, to say that Tirmanam, you are giving some kind of a rhythm, a finale or an arudhi or whatever you call it, to the your dance pattern. So you can say it, recite it three times, doesn't matter. So when it brings, you take any Vaitari, when you are incorporating into Mohiniyattam, you have to remember that Mohiniyattam can have adopt both Shailis. Mm-hmm. The one which it got in the court of Swadhi Trinal, and one which now we can incorporate because it is a regional incorporation, you know, to bring it closer to the region.
Right. Now, one question I'd like to ask is: Do you still use mridangam as your percussion instrument and not mandalam? So, when you are trying to, I mean, if you have to show these talas to your mridangist who is completely into the Carnatic tala paddhati, how is that challenge? How do you tackle that?
Yeah, this is a very good question, pertinent question, I would say. Actually, I wanted to have the mandalam also, In fact, one concert of mine, I have used mandalam and edekya. What I noticed there was that to the rhythmic pattern, it's good. The nritya aspect, nritya also is good. But when it came to certain nritya, which had too much of bhava, you had to have a soft tonal rhythmic accompaniment. Madalam at that time, the tone of the madalam was little loud than expected, unless you make him sit so far away from the mic, which is not very fair. So ideally, if you can incorporate all three, the best, because for nritya, madalam is excellent.
Yes,
but when it comes to nritya and bhava, apart from the edekya, the tonal quality of mridangam is far better suited for the soft footwork and the flowing movements of Mohiniyattam. So what I did was, I made my mridangam use those syllables. So now you will find my mridangam has also started playing those vaitaris. I have made him by heart all those vaitaris, and he is doing it exceptionally well. Plus, even the edekya. In Kerala, I found there were many edekya players who have accompanied me for Mohiniyattam. They have been excellent in providing me rhythmic support, edekya support, for enhancing my on-the-spot bhavas. Fine. But when it came to their playing, accompanying that exact vaitari, they could not do it. It was very difficult. So here I have an edekya player who is equally accomplished in not only executing the bhavas but also in the vaitaris. Yes. If you see any of my performance, you'll find the edekya and mridangam are doing the same vaitari which I'm performing with my footwork. It is something that you have to initiate. You see, it's not that mridangam is supposed to play only for Carnatic music. Why? Mridangam can play for any classical performance where it has been playing. It's how you want to mold your performance. That's important.
That's right.
But you have to be sensitive in what you are doing.
Right. Correct. That's right. Ma'am, also coming from the same line, there's another question that I have in mind. It's about the choreographic aspect. I mean, when you took these vaidyaris, you had to adapt it to the style of Mohiniyattam. You said that we have to stick to the framework. Now, when the musical pattern or the feel of the music kind of changes, does your inherent movement also, do you feel there's any difference that you get in the inherent movements that you've already learned? And you know, is there an added quality to it?
Yeah. See, even Yendaho Vallabha, which I learned from Kalyani Kutiyamma, I have tried to further explore the padam. Because there is no dearth, there is no limit to the explorations. What I teach you today, I don't expect you to be a copycat. Mm. You're supposed to take it forward.
Yes.
So, like Yendaho Vallabha also, I learned only that the first standing, that is very essential. You know, that pose wherein you have the Trayashra pose with a sama and a feet in Trayashra position and your hand on one side, your neck too, on the other side with a smita smile and your eyes giving that subtle expression of love, Sringara. That standing first position is most important. That will immediately reflect, oh, this is the style. This is Mohiniyattam.
Hmm.
After that, what I learned was that Yendaho Vallabha, that drishti. Inniram maunabhavam. You have to first show a smile, a very shyness, because you don't know how to approach. Now, when Kalyani Kutiyamma taught me this, she made me only look at Yendaho Vallabha, the Vallabha, and then Inneram Mauna Bhavam. Why are you not talking? So, Mauna Bhavam. So, Yenda, she taught me like this. Yenda Ho Vallabha Inneram Mauna Bhavam. So, these were the three principal mudras she taught me. I thought I could expand perhaps a little more. First, just looking at Vallabha and being too shy to even speak out. And then looking up again at his bhava. Oh, he doesn't seem to be in a very happy or a very a moment where he can share your love with him. No, he doesn't look that tight. He's slightly disturbed or affected. So when you look at him, then you try to wonder, why is he looking like in that? What is it that has happened? You start wondering that about it. So you look at him and you are taken in by the fact that he's not in the mood that you were expecting. And then you are thinking, what could be the reason? And then you just shrug it off. No, that this must be my imagination. Perhaps, you know, you can take it in any way. Perhaps it's my imagination. Perhaps I can win him over. I mean, how do you feel at that time? That's how you have to conceive. But once you decide about how you want to feel that, then all the Sanchari Bhava should go accordingly.
The same route.
Yes. It should not be in a conflict. Mm-hmm. Even Bhavas of anger or bhaya, any bhava that you want to add into that has to be in tandem with your main the main sthai bhava, which is of Shringara, right? So then you can say, what is it? And then you can get affected by whatever. I mean, there are several ways of doing. I can't do it here, unfortunately. So maybe one day I'll use that. And then I will show there are almost 6 to 7 ways, maybe more, you can explore. And how Yendaho Vallabha, Innera Mauna Bhav, this is how she taught, like, Innera Mauna Bhavam, Mauna Bhavam, this was another way. This is one way she took Yendaho Vallabha. So, certain things that she taught me, in between, I tried to interweave certain other bhavas, which I found would add up to that, right? So you can always explore those possibilities. There is no end to that.
Right. We were talking earlier about the Kaishiki Vritti seminar that you conducted, and unfortunately, I missed it. My guru, Vinita Nirangadi, also missed it because of some unforeseen reasons. But I mean, that was a very well-acclaimed seminar that you conducted, which brought together so many different styles of Mohiniyattam and gurus and teachers, practitioners together. So, knowing the fact that you've based yourself in Delhi earlier, you did mention a little earlier how you received a lot of criticism. Because at that point of time, I don't know, I'm guessing probably Delhi audiences weren't so well-versed with the slow kind of, you know, Andolika, Chauka movements that we have in Mohiniyattam. So was that a challenge for you? Like, how did you help yourself in, you know, standing side by side with art forms like Kathak, which is so much of speed and rhythm, and Bharatanatyam, whereas Mohiniyattam, of course, has a lot of rhythm, but there's a particular, I mean, I think one needs to be acquainted to the art form to actually enjoy it so well. So how did you look upon this challenge that you had in?
I just did Indumukhi Padavarnam, then this Amba Gauri Padavarnam. All that is in a Vilamba Kala. All that is in a Vilamba Kala. I have never meddled with the pace of that Padavarnam because that has been set. It's a preset composition. Now, when you are performing with in a Kathak or you know, something which is very fast, even Odissi for that matter. The Odissis that I've seen, I have watched performances of Indrani Rahmanji when I was young in Delhi. I have seen, watched a performance. Those performances were very, very slow. They were too slow. By today's standard, I don't think so that kind of a pace would have really gelled with the audience. Because for that, you really need an audience who has that kind of a kind of a mental attitude to watch and enjoy that pace. You don't have that mental attitude of people today. There are rasikas maybe there, but not with that mental attitude. You want a certain pace, you want a certain duration, and there are challenges that come with that. Odissi has also gone into a very fast tempo movement. When I started first performing, with the research work that I had, Shabda Chali, Shiva Chali, these were pure dances. They were not much of a nritya, or they were not much of an abhinaya in that. So that gave me scope to enhance my speed from the vilamba to a madhya laya, not the druta. I have never performed a druta. But that madhya laya also doesn't mean that it is ati madhya, it is slightly towards a druta madhya. I could go to the Druta-Madhya Laya also. But because those compositions which I was doing had scope for that. Now, that doesn't mean that when I do Yanta Vallabha, I cannot do that. There, I cannot do a Madhya. It has to be Vilamba. So, whenever there were group compositions, which I even now I see, if requires, time requires, if the audience require you, and it's a pure dance, you can enhance the duration. And this is something that I abide by, I will always abide by, so long as you are not compromising with the form, the technique, and movement. You can do enhance. But that doesn't mean that you can be so fast as a Tilana of Bharatanatyam, or you know, Pallavi of a Odissi that they are doing these days, or a Kathak that they have. It does not mean that you should have that kind of pace. But yes, the beauty of Mohiniyattam, the songs and the setup of compositions is most ideally suited for a vilamba. I would say not an ati vilamba, but for a vilamba. It's most suited for that.
Ma'am, another question is about the Tali Nangagal, the dancers, the Devadasis who you've mentioned in your book, who existed in Kerala, who practiced their art form, and you've mentioned that Mohiniyattam is a continuation of what they performed earlier. Could you throw some light on that? Give us some more information about how you figured these.
These were certain informations, or whatever you may call, gathered by my mother. Because from temples like Suchindram and Tiruvattar Adikeshava. You know, Suchindram temple had lot of this Devadasi system existing even in the late 19th century. They had that. And my grandfather, who happened to be also one of those members of the several committees, you know, which ran the temple services, which were a part of the temple services. My mother somehow had an access to many of these informations, many of these what you called as data or facts, you may say. She had direct access to certain rituals and certain processes which were connected to these rituals. So from there, whatever she gathered, and also a great, I would say, here we were a lot of valid and solid information were given to us by T. Shankaran Mama, who was kind of my godfather. T. Shankaran, who was the first cousin of T. Bala Saraswati. So he was the first secretary of Tamil Isai Sangam in Chennai. And he and my mother had several interactions about the Devadasi tradition and culture. In fact, whenever he used to come to Delhi, he would stay with us. Douglas Knight, I mean, Bala Saraswati's son-in-law, he has come before marriage. He has come and stayed with us. And, you know, all these T. Vishwanathan sir, they have stayed with us. He has also stayed with us. Interaction with Mama gave her a lot of inputs about the practicing of these Devadasi traditions and systems. Though there is some kind of, even now we have not been able to reach the actual evidence about the system, whether being a part of the Kerala or a Tamil Nadu. We really don't know for sure. But this is for sure that there were nangais, the beautiful hand, whether it was meant for because of the gestures that they used beautifully, nangais, beautiful hand, or whether because they had beautiful hands. I don't know. We can't say. Nankai only we know. So whether the gestures were beautiful or hands, we are not very sure. But this is surely there, that there were dasis who were a part of the temple, who lived in the temple. They were not seen by they were not allowed to communicate with the people outside the sanctum, only to remain within the sanctum. And my mother used to say it was a kind of a, not a very, it was a kind of a, I'm not getting that word right now, a celibacy, a life of celibacy was a kind of a very, very unfair life that these nankais connected to the sanctum led, because their becoming a nankai and their exiting, their death, nobody knew. Because by the time they reached an old age, there was another nankai who was groomed. Yes. So nobody knew. Only a nankai was performing, that's all. So there were those Uttama, Madhyama and Adhama nankai, which you know about,
yes,
who were supposed to live outside the temple and who were mainly to do the temple with regards to cleaning of the temple.
Yes.
You know, that we all know about. But this is something that she could gather a lot with some of her interaction with the in Suchindram temple, with some of the people there, temple people.
So these nangais were supposed to be in that area, which means it could be inferred that way. Would it be right?
That is something I can't say for sure, whether they were where they were. But Suchindram, certainly, there were certain dasis there. There was certain dasis there. And with the interaction with T. Shankaran Mama, we could somehow bridge that gap. My mother could bridge that gap between these nankais and the dasis, the devadasis, or dasi atoms, I mean,
right,
the dasis that we have.
Correct.
But you know, it's very difficult to actually really know whether they were, who were the Ganikas at that time, who were the Dasis, because they had two roles to play. We know about that. The Ganikas, the Dasis, yes, the Dasis were also part of the temple rituals. The Dasis were also those who entertained the kings. So there are several, I would say, connotations that have been connected with these Dasis. So we have to further explore that, I would say. Whatever my mother could explore and I could understand from her is what I have actually published in my book, the vanishing temple arts. Here I have given about certain stri nrityam also, which only two lines my mother knew, and she taught me that. And you know, that is Aao Asara Tero Busara. Now nobody knows about what it meant, but that was the period of decline when such music came and such songs were written. So all that is there briefly written in my book. You can, if you go through that, you'll get some idea of what I have researched.
There is so much to know. I mean, I would like to keep asking you more questions, but I know both of us, there is a shortage of time. But ma'am, I want to ask you one thing that I've been asking almost all the artists, guest speakers who've come on this show, is about their concept of Lasya. As a dancer, you will, I think one will have their own, I mean, bhava for the concept of Lasya in themselves. So how would you look at Lasya? What is Lasya to you?
Well, as I said, Lasya, if you have read Natyashastra, if you read Sangeet Ratnakara, if you read Nitya Ratnavali, where Lasyangas are there, there are innumerable interpretation to that term. So
yes,
Lasati iti Lasya, you know, that which is pleasing, that that which creates that aura around in, when you are watching, that is Lasya, you know. So it could be anything from aesthetically developing a movement, and how aesthetically you define develop that movement will certainly and surely depend upon your inner sanskara. See, if you have a sanskara which is different from me, your outlook and your interpretation to that term and a movement will be quite different from how I interpret. So everything comes down to that basic dormant sanskara.
Very true. Lovely. That was a very good takeaway actually for several dancers like me. Now, ma'am, another thing is, we know that you are a musician as well. You hold a very high post in the University of Delhi, as I mentioned in the beginning. How much would you emphasize the study of classical music for classical dancers? I know it's something everybody would say, but you are somebody who's experienced the, you know, the benefit of having both of these in your palms. So how has it helped you, and how much would you emphasize the study of classical music for students of dance?
Remember when I had many years back, when I had gone to Kavalam Narayana Panikkar's Maman's house, I used to call him Maman till his last breath. I mean, whenever I used to meet him, whenever we used to go to Kerala, my parents and I, we were regularly invited for lunch at his place.
Right. Okay.
We were a close family, friends. So Maman used to make me listen to these rare songs, folk songs and all in it, which he had recorded, folk songs which had typical nuances of Sobhana. And there I could understand the rhythmic aspect of that only because I had a strong foundation of Carnatic music. And Maman used to always say that you cannot say that Carnatic music clashes with Sobhana. In fact, it helps in the enhancement of Sobhana. See, sometimes the sopana singers may sing from their bhava, no doubt. But if they know that this is the shruti, this is the swara that this raga happens, these are the exploration possibilities that can come only when you learn a completely organized system of music, and which is Carnatic music. Carnatic music is a very scientifically and organized system of music. So when you learn the talas, when you say seven sapta suladi talas, or you say 35 with the five gatis and the five jatis and the five gatis with 135 talas, so we don't learn all that, but the alankaras, when you practice the alankara of suladi sapta talas, when you learn the ragam tanam pallavi in one of the most trickiest nalakalai ettukalai, which I have learned. I actually presented an ettukalai pallavi when I did my MPhil, and I got a gold medal. I topped in that. There was no gold medal, but I topped in my MPhil only because of that ettukalai pallavi which I executed, which my guru taught me, Vidwan D.S. Raghavan. I'm so grateful to God that I had a Vidwan like him as my guru. And also Srimad Akhila Krishnan also was my Carnatic music guru, who taught me how to bring in the bhava in your tala. While one guru taught me how to bring the rhythmic permutation combination, the other guru taught me how to bring the raga bhava into that.
One step ahead.
Right. So all this and my training in my as BA, MA, MPhil, which I had in my department, I was a student of music all throughout. With people like T.R. Subramanian, Sangeetha Kalanidhi, T.R. Subramanian sir, who was a Pallavi Vidwan, I had those great teachers as my guru teaching in my faculty. I had, I would say, a better understanding of the talas than perhaps those who have never learned music. It is a must. You must learn music. But also, like some people learn Bharatanatyam, Mohiniyattam, Kuchipudi, Kathakali, everything, Kathak also, just to have an understanding. No. You have to go to that only after you have mastered one style. Master one style. Then you will be able to understand the other style better. So you must learn.
Definitely. Thank you so much, ma'am. It was an absolute pleasure listening to you. As I said, I could go on listening to you because so much is coming out of just this 1 hour. I can only imagine how much you still have to share. But thank you so much for taking out this time. Deeply grateful to you. Thank you. Namaste.
Thank you.